we'd like to welcome you. I think for some of you, this is your first time to visit our office since we've moved from Makati, although we've been here for 3 years. And as my colleague says, there's a more corporate look. But we're looking forward to this forum this morning because, as you know, PIDS, we very much like to provide one of the venues for exchange of ideas, and this forum on this partnership with UNDP on expanding and deepening the relevance and effectiveness of higher education institutions for eradicating poverty at the local level is very important to us. For PIDS, we have been working with higher education institutions for some of our projects. In fact, for one of my projects in evaluating the impact of agricultural insurance, we've worked with higher education institutions in the regions because we know that they have the presence, the capacity, and also the commitment to do something within their own communities and localities. And so this is something that we think would be a sustainable way to generate research and knowledge and also apply this knowledge that could be used by local governments as well as civil society organizations. So the forum this morning is something that we've been looking forward. We've done a lot of research on studies related to the MDGs as well as the SDGs. In fact, my team is working on poverty, and so we have some findings that we can share with you this morning, but really more to indicate areas for collaboration with HEIs rather than sharing with you the findings of all the studies that we've done. So we're really, really looking forward to having this exchange of ideas, not just once. We're hoping that this will become probably a regular partnership with UNDP to facilitate more knowledge sharing and discussion. So again, welcome to the IDS.
Thank you, Dr. Shalia, for those welcoming remarks. Now, may I please call on Dr. Andrew Parker to discuss the forum program and objectives.
Thank you, Paolo, and good morning to everybody. Very nice to see you all here, and thank you for coming, some near and some from further away. So we're happy you could all be here with us this morning. I'm just going to run very quickly through the program. You have it in front of you. But I thought I just useful to take us through the day's events. We're going to start after the initial remarks from Celia and Noel. We'll have an open discussion. In a little while, I'll give you the sort of the official line, if you like, on the leaving no one behind. This is very much a sort of strong feature in the 2030 agenda, and I'll give you a little bit of a perspective from the UNDP side. But I think it's important that we, you know, we look at that with a critical eye and with a view to thinking about how that applies locally and what it means locally here in the Philippines. Toby will take us through the morning discussion, and we look forward to your, and I'm sure we'll get it from you, active participation and contributions to those discussions. I know you all have views and opinions and experiences to share, so we look forward to hearing from you during that. Then we'll have a good lunch. And in the afternoon, I think we'll decide. We suggested perhaps breaking into small groups, but I think as perhaps we're a relatively small group altogether, we might just stay as one. Let's see how that, let's see how the body feels about that. A little bit later, we can see what would make most use. My country director Titon Mitra will join us hopefully for lunch in the afternoon session, and I know he's looking forward very much to meeting, catching up with some of you and meeting some of you for the first time and hearing about the discussions. So that's just a kind of quick run through of the program. I'd like now to turn to Dr. Noel de Dios to give us some opening remarks. research that she's been doing on an important aspect of the Leaving No One Behind agenda. So, Noel, thanks very much.
Thank you, Andrew. Well, first of all, I'd like to greet my friend and colleague, Dr. Celia Reyes, again, congratulate her on her appointment as PIDS president. This is my first time, actually, in this this venue, to be honest. The second remark is that I don't pretend to have a very coherent set of comments, but these are reflections on how universities and HEIs in general might have a role in local poverty alleviation. So actually the title of my slide presentation is Do, Can, Should Universities Have a Role in Local Poverty Alleviation? So it's a set of questions that I pose. Well, first of all, to put things in context, I think we ought to be aware of larger, long-term big changes that are taking hold of the Philippine economy, aside from the political. First of all, we have a historically unique situation in which the Philippines has sustained per capita income growth over a long period of time, since 2010. So technically that qualifies as what Rodri and Hausman call a growth acceleration, which means that GDP per capita has grown about 3.5% per annum per capita over 8 years. That it's significantly higher than the past years. And that's a very rare occurrence, actually, worldwide. And for the Philippines, it's the first time. By contrast, other countries have had two, in the case of China, even three episodes of growth acceleration in its economic history. And then, of course, as was announced in the papers, the country is looking forward to graduating to an upper middle income status by 2019 and 2020. The upshot of this is a question: will the poor ultimately be a minority in society? And what kind of a constituency will the poor represent in society? As of 2015, as you know, the poor, technically defined by PSA, was about 22% of the population. And we try to apply some World Bank criteria in slightly different from the PSA, and we find that what they would have classified as the very poor and poor, the very poor would be about 10%, the poor 23%, the vulnerable 30%. Economically secure, significantly in that classification, would be about almost a third, including the upper middle class. Here you have a kind of chart saying that, of course, you see that the vulnerable have also risen, but that's partly a graduation of the poor and the very poor to higher category. And on the other hand, you see a gradual rise in the middle class. So what is the upshot of this? Well, we should worry that when you get to a middle class status as a country and you have an increasing middle class, you might have an erosion, what I call an erosion of empathy and social solidarity. It's probably not so evident now, but well, this is something we might need to worry about in the near future. The middle class may become apathetic and self-absorbed in their fairly comfortable situation, and because we're a democracy, as and when the composition of society changes, the policy may also shift. So when you talk of populist, you no longer talk about intervention in behalf of the neediest part of society, but might be more tailored to the upper and middle classes. And there's a risk that a pro-poor agenda might fall between the cracks as well. Maybe I'm just a worrier, but I see some of this in the middle class toleration of the extrajudicial killings. In some middle class legislation, like free state college tuition, train to some extent, raising of pensions. None of these are in and of themselves objectionable. In fact, some of them may be good and progressive. After all, they do help a significant portion of the population. But in the future, is it possible that the poor, as the title says, might be left behind? That there might be certain sections of the population about which the rest of society does not care too much about, about which the rest of society does not care too much. That, I think, is a distinct possibility. And on the other hand, so I'm just raising questions. On the other hand, take a look at the direction of HEIs, higher education institutions. The challenge of this workshop is to try to see how HEIs can play a positive role in poverty alleviation. But that has to be internalized and implemented ultimately by the HEIs themselves. But if we put ourselves in their situation and the kinds of imperatives that they think they ought to be responding to, what are they? Well, we already know from that traditionally the aspirations of HEIs are actually cosmopolitan, that it is not specific. Knowledge always tries to be universal and general, generalizable. Of course, the caricature of this might be the natural sciences. So the premium is to be given to work that has international, universal application. At the very least, a national significance. Secondly, another peculiarity of HEIs and universities in general, I live in one, is the compartmentalization among disciplines, which we already know hinders the approach to complex problems. I have a quote from Gunnar Myrdal's Asian Drama is 50 years old this year. And this is his quote. No? So if you think about development problems per se, it's very hard to subdivide them into disciplines. But knowledge in universities is organized that way, according to disciplinal boundaries. And in practice, it's very hard to get people to work together. You have to be friends. I mean, there is no natural way to get people from different disciplines to work together. So, compartmentalization. And then, of course, we already know that HEIs already see themselves as agents for social mobility to the extent that they fulfill their traditional role. They're already saying that, an education will give somebody a chance in society. We are the means for social mobility. So, do we have to do anything different? We are already doing what society wants us to do. We are already fulfilling the social role that you're asking us to have. that self-contained social role and function leads to kind of sluggishness when it comes to working in non-traditional activities. But in addition, I think in the Philippines there are peculiar circumstances of universities that make them struggle to respond to projects like poverty alleviation, especially in their localities. One is, of course, the situation of most local universities, which is that time is completely preempted by standard pedagogy. There's no time even for research in general, much less research on poverty, much less creative research on local poverty alleviation. So that militates against experimentation and novelty, this preemption of time. And then if you're talking about private HEIs, especially the less endowed ones, there's simply a question of budgets and enrollments that they must worry about, especially with free state college tuition. They need to worry about it even more. And then the problem is somewhat different for the leading edge or higher level HEIs. For them, the push is towards leading edge research, in particular an emphasis on STEM. And for higher quality in terms of international recognition. This is a table from Quaccarelli Simons, QS. And you can imagine the imperative or marching orders of even the leading Philippine universities when they see something like this. So there's UP, number 374. It's beaten by Chula, well, University of Malaysia, never mind China, okay? University of Malaya, Chula, University of Putra, Mahidol, Malaysia. Oh, this is a surprise. UI even beats UP, UI. So, if this is the kind of situation that even the quality HEIs find themselves in, what do you think is the marching order from their boards of regents, or their alumni, or the government even, you know, officially? It would be, you need to pull yourselves up. And how do you do that? The typical response to that is to do the traditional role of universities, which is research. Research in well-defined standard fields. So again, novelty, experimentation, it's a challenge to be able to be novel and experiment at the leading edge, and at the same time fulfill the role of a research university and push yourself up. I have a few words to say about why that might be possible, but offhand, it's a challenge. So, and that explains what current practice is, actually, that it is inadequate, as you might expect. First of all, there's a low level of research, more generally. That's because of the existing talent pool. We're starting from a very uneven distribution of talent and intellectual leaders or leading researchers as distributed among the many HEIs in the country. The proportion, for example, of PhDs in STEM, well, there's an article that's coming out in BRE, that kind of reviews that. very low. And in general, even in, actually even UP is a bit, is quite substandard if you compare it to other universities in the region, which is part of the reason that UP ranks, even UP ranks pretty low. And then given the time constraints, given the traditional disciplinary subdivisions, you will find that a lot of the research, even on poverty, will be fragmented, episodic, and will be distributed among individual faculty rather than a team, typically a team effort that's self-motivated. And poverty alleviation research is actually still, for the moment, I think it's still there. But at the especially at the local level, it's not something that immediately comes to mind on the part of local universities or regional, even regional universities, either because they do not have the opportunity to do it or they lack some of the capacity to implement it. And typically it is at the instance of, and this is something we can talk about later, of external agents like PIDS or some donor agency that motivates, or some private philanthropic effort that motivates regional universities to undertake these fields. As a self-sustaining activity on the part of local universities, it's very rare. And then actually, as I mentioned, the the mantra for HEIs for a upper middle income country is actually to move towards higher quality, more STEM, more integration into the mainstream of research as it is perceived, as it is conducted in the more developed countries, being part of that dialogue. I think that's the internal imperative for most HEIs at this time. On the other hand, why should we do it? After all, given all of these difficulties, why should we care? Actually, that's the problem. If the national agenda changes, we might be caring less and less. Well, first of all, HEIs are founded on humanitarian and social basis. And in the face of human need, there is that imperative to intervene and to involve yourself, because that is part of the human condition. And the upliftment of the human condition is a basic foundation of the of an any HEI. From a more practical viewpoint, one might argue that active engagement can be an effective pedagogical and research method. It's a challenge, however, because, I'll talk about it later, because in order to do that, you might need a great deal of talent to be innovative. Well, on the other hand, you might say that, in particular, local work, look at academically, to the extent that you have access to those conditions, it's something that can be an advantage. It's like having your own data set and being able to research on that basis, and the data set is available to yourself and to no one else. That's certainly some academic advantage if you are able to leverage it and format it properly. Fourth, again, looking at the advantage to the HEI, looking at a complex problem, of course, may serve, a persuasive complex but complex problem, may serve as the motivation and the vehicle to actually foster cross-disciplinary collaboration among the various colleges and faculties inside it can serve as the organizing principle for cross-disciplinary collaboration. Fifth, it has always been a problem for HEIs to reach out to the outside. And the complaint for the upper middle income, you might want to get used to that thing, that the UMI complaint is that we don't link up enough with businesses, that our research is not relevant to the outside world, the ivory tower syndrome. But poverty research can become a vehicle for institutional partnerships across HEIs, between HEI and business, HEIs and NGOs, and HEIs and various levels of the government. It can expand university influence and create a network. So these are just some reasons, I think, why it might be both a social imperative and a moral imperative for HEIs to be engaged in poverty research. But again, the challenge is, these are some examples of that we might take a look at. Most of us are familiar, I think, with the idea of randomized controlled trials. This is a method that was prevalent in the medical profession. When you want to test a drug, you actually try it in a very controlled, randomized way, scientific way. Now, the big idea was, why don't we do this also for social interventions? You can have a control group and an intergroup where you intervene. So the big idea is to do this not only for drug tests, but also for social interventions. And it's that group by Banerjee, Duflo, et al. From MIT that made that. But what's the big thing about it? The fact that it was a method that was novel, but at the same time, concretely relevant to a problem at hand, a problem of alleviating poverty. And in the end, the caricature now is that you won't get published until you have an RCT as the basis of your data or your argument. Maybe that's an overstatement. But it does tell you that it is possible to be both relevant and leading edge in the field. But of course, what is needed there will be resources and talent. Imagine if a university had the opportunity to do this, then it would fulfill its upper middle income job. But at the same time, actually do something for people in terms of helping policy, helping design policy that will improve the lot of the poor. So that's one example. The Poverty Action Lab, I think, at MIT is still there. And actually what they've done since is, we've met some of these people, they've spun off some of that. So the method is already done. But they did not stop with developing that method, and it's already been done by a lot of people. They spun it off into an NGO that actually catalogs and documents and actually does randomized controlled experiments. Forget the name of that now. I don't think it is the Poverty Action Lab itself. They have an NGO. So not directly related, but it's as if you have a, it's almost like the venture capitalism model in Silicon Valley. You have a good idea. It's theoretically sound, it's publishable, And then what you do is you spin it off. Somebody else takes care of implementing it. So that process, if that were done in the local universities, could generate a lot of knowledge, but also a lot of policy improvements. So that's one example. Another institute that's been put up is, I think the one, this is associated with Jeff Sachs, the Earth Institute of Columbia. It's a multidisciplinary effort at what is essentially a new thing. It's Earth System Science, and they folded it into the normal, they're trying to normalize it as part of the university, so they have research as well as degrees being granted. So in a way, you're able to fold in the social relevance and recognize that, you know, in a university that has its own incentive system and valuation of output, and if you're able to fold in the work into this regular valuation systems, then there's a greater chance of it being sustainable as an activity inside the university. So actually, research in Earth System Science, I think the initial thing they had was an observatory, so it's hard science. But then they supplemented with social science. So what is the effect of global warming? What is the localization of this this thing? You have a global view, but at the same time, you're able to particularize its significance to specific locations. Sustainable Development Solutions Network. This again is the initiative, I think, of Sachs, but also the United Nations in relation to the Sustainable Development Goals. The idea is, it's still rather new. The idea is that they would get a network of universities globally and in each country and each region to have a vigorous exchange of ideas on solutions. The focus, according to Sachs, is to look for solutions to or approaches for the SDGs. In the Philippines, there is a that's the last one there. There is a network that's still struggling to get up and running. I know until recently I was head of it. So we're still working on a way of coming together. I'll tell you about it in a little while. Then, of course, locally, there's a human development network. That's relevant to the extent that this is a group of mostly academics, but it's wider in scope. There are government people, there are NGOs that are part of it. But it's organized around the knowledge product. I guess it's valuable less to the extent that it's a university type environment. Not even officially sanctioned by any university, but the ability to work around a common theme. Then there's UCIDS. I'm semi-involved in a project there called Escaping the Middle Income Trap. And what this organization does is to do action research in cooperation with business to help small farmers form a value chain and increase the value of their output. What is needed? I think, just go through this quickly. The challenge is to integrate local poverty research into the mainstream of academic life, because I think if we're not able to do that, it will not be a sustainable activity on the part of the university. And what's needed, I think, is something that can immediately be done, I think, at the lowest level is you might consider being locally relevant by having affirmative action in terms of admissions, scholarship, and mentoring for members of the local community. For example, families we've never had a member of them finish college can probably be given some priority. But in addition to admissions, I know some schools in Manila are doing this. There's intensive mentoring because they're able to monitor the progress. And this is through investment in IT. Mentor the progress of specific students. It can even lead to research on equity and social mobility as you follow these students through time. I think the point is to realize that as schools, you have a wealth of big data already before you. And if you can leverage that into research, particular research regarding social mobility and poverty, then you're already some way. Second, and I think it's the most important, we need knowledge entrepreneurs. Well, essentially, these are just good scholars who see the potential of poverty problems in terms of generating knowledge, especially at the local level. So this really goes into the question of the faculty or the research staff in the university. Anyway, the third thing is, well, obviously, the university must be familiar and receptive to applying new approaches, which means being leveling up to things like things that are, in a way, state of the art. No? For example, RCTs, data science, action research, cross-disciplinary approaches involving STEM. Columbia Institute does that. No? It's physical science supplemented with social science. IT-supported pedagogies that can help you, barring privacy issues, help you monitor the progress of your student. And then it's important to have to be open to networking and collaboration. If you recognize that the current staff does not have that that capacity, then partnering with other institutions is certainly the way to go. And then ultimately, I think there needs to be a commitment if it is sustained. Specialized units on faculties may need to be devoted to research and networking. So spin-off organizations may also be formed to implement lessons of research, like the examples I gave. So I think I will end there. This is the answer to the question that I posed. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Noel, very much. Let's move straight away. Bit of a change of perspective. So I think these two will go together very nicely to kind of give us the view from Noel's point of view, and then Celia is going to share with us some specific research that she's been involved with recently.
Thank you,
Andrew.
Noel and I have been talking before the forum, but I'm glad that he went ahead of me, because what I'm going to do is actually provide some examples of this collaboration. And I'm just using one or two studies we've done as examples, but really show some areas of collaboration that research institutions like PIDS and HEIs can collaborate in, and also some of the challenges and opportunities that HEIs actually face. As Noel mentioned, actually, we've been quite lucky. We've had continuous economic growth above 6% since 2012. And this is something that's remarkable for the Philippines, because we've always had a boom-bust cycle. But since 2012, we've been experiencing over 6% GDP growth. And the poverty rate has actually gone down from 1991. If you look at the 9 from 34.4% in 1991 to 21.6% in 2015. So the proportion of the poor has actually gone down. But if you look at the magnitude between 1991 and 2015, the number of poor has not really changed significantly since 1991. So that means that it's still a problem. We're hoping, and Noel and I are hoping, that the number of the poor would go down so there would be no area of research. But I think we still have to look at this particular issue for the next few years. And I think what's more, I think striking is that while poverty incidence is lowest in NCR, Metro Manila, it's just 3.9%. But if you look at ARM, over more than half of the population are actually income poor, 53.7%. So if you look at the maps, they're actually color-coded. So the red shaded areas are the poorer regions, and the green ones are the less poor regions. So the dark green would indicate the best performing regions, followed by the light green, and then pink, and then the red. So you can see that in general, Luzon is generally better off than Visayas and Mindanao. And in terms of inequality, the country has not made significant progress in reducing inequality. If you look at all areas, that's the top line. It has gone down a little bit from 0.48 to 0.453, but a Gini coefficient higher than 0.4 actually indicates that there's really a large high inequality. And if you look at the urban areas, it has gone down from 0.475 to 0.429 over the same period. But if you look at the inequality in the rural areas, it has actually gone up during the same period. And so indicating that, okay, while we actually welcome this non-farm activities in the rural areas, actually it has contributed to increasing inequality in those areas. And in fact, if you look at the share of the poorest 20% of the population, take note that 5.44 means that only 5% of the total income goes to the poorest 20% of the population. And it has actually increased very little from 1991 to 2015, from 5% to 5.44. And if you look at the ratio of the richest decile to poorest decile, that means the average income of those belonging to the top 10% is about 16%, or 16 times the average income of the poorest 10% of the population. And although it has gone down a little bit, but still quite significant. And so what I wanted to show was just really to provide you some findings, just to show you some examples of opportunities for collaboration. Also, what is needed to be able to engage in local research, particularly in the areas of poverty alleviation. So I won't bother you with the definition, but I thought I'd share with you one of the studies that we've done, inequality of opportunities in education among ethnic groups in the Philippines. The reason we got started on this was we wanted to see what's happening in Mindanao. And so we looked at ethnic groups, and we found out there are about 182 ethno-linguistic groups. And so it was really difficult to characterize all these 182 groups. So we were looking for major groupings. And so we went to NCIP, we went to Muslim Affairs and other government agencies, and they couldn't provide us with fewer groupings. So they were asking PIDS to do this for them. And so what we did was just to come up with some an official classification. We're not suggesting that this is the only way to do it, but we just wanted to group some of these 182 groups together just to see whether there are some patterns that we could observe from this. So we just grouped the 182 groups into Muslim ethnic groups, both IPs, indigenous peoples, and non-IPs, non-Muslim IPs ethnic group, and the non-Muslim non-IPs ethnic group. And this is just the listing. By the way, not all of the data surveys being conducted by PSA actually this is something that we would want to encourage to be done in all. The reason for that is I think for leaving no one behind. Although we've seen that we have done well in some of the indicators, particularly because of our focus on the MDGs until 2015, I think achieving the last mile is going to be more challenging. And so what you need really is more disaggregated data so you can actually see, okay, who are you trying to reach up to, you know, for the last few percentage points. While we could be happy and say that, okay, our school participation rate is 95%, making it 100% is going to be very, very much more difficult than increasing your school participation rate from 80% to 90%. And so this requires actually more disaggregated information. And so what we have here, and this just shows the distribution of the three ethnic groups. As I said, we just did this because we wanted to see, okay, are there differences, but there could be better ways of grouping them. And this is actually just where they are. And you will notice I didn't emphasize anymore, but we had to use the census of population and housing, which happens only every 10 years. And so you don't really have a lot of frequent up-to-date information to be able to do this kind of research. And of course, everybody's familiar with this, the K-12 basic education curriculum. And what we find here, we wanted to compare, okay, what has been, if any, changes between 2000 and in 2010. And this is by single year of age, proportion of children attending school, and broken lines pertain to 2000, year 2000, and the lines pertain to the data for 2010. And what we can see is that, as expected, school participation rate is usually higher for the younger cohort, children, and then it goes down as children become older because they drop out of school, to augment family income, and so forth, or physical access to school. So while you have elementary schools in every barangay, you don't have high schools in all barangays. And also what we find is that over time, the school participation rate among younger children increased, but it actually decreased among the older cohort. So you see the dotted lines are higher actually when you go up to, okay, I cannot use the okay. So Muslim ethnic groups have the lowest school participation rate. I think there have been very few studies on looking at disparities across ethnic groups. And so Muslim, what we find is that Muslim ethnic groups have the lowest school participation rate. And we just computed some inequality measures. I am not going to go through this, but just wanted to show that while inequality actually has gone down in terms of years of schooling and literacy between 2000 and 2010, there's still significant within group and between group disparities. And so this is something that could be looked at. And what we actually did was to look at ethnic groups of the 182. We actually tried to look at the 182 ethnic groups, but it was difficult. We're not familiar. We tried. It was more an academic research. We weren't familiar with why a certain ethnic group was performing not so well. And this is something that we would like to continue working on. How come some ethnic groups were performing quite well, some ethnic groups were not performing quite well with regards to some of these indicators? And I think this is one, I think, area where the HDIs would be in a better position to explain how come some ethnic groups don't value education as much, higher education as much, as compared to some other ethnic groups. Better than a researcher based in Quezon City would be able to do. We could use maps, overlay maps, and see location of households and be able to say something about physical access. But I think value being placed by the families, by the individuals on education, or other constraints existing in the locality, I think the local HEIs might be in a better position to do that. So this just shows the years of schooling and literacy rate, and they've generally improved. And what we're actually seeing also is that within group component have largely contributed to total inequality. So even within the groups, so it's not just disparities across groups that's accounting for the inequality, but it's really inequality within the group that contributes to this total inequality. Okay, so for instance, here this one example, IP groups like Sama Laot, Sama Bajau, and Bajau had low educational outcomes, and non-IP groups like Palawani and Marano had high educational outcomes. We can only describe this, but I think the HEIs in those regions would be better placed to be able to explain why you have these kinds of findings. Is it physical access? Is it economic access? Is it, you know, just the values they place on education or something else? And what we're finding is that we also use the Human Opportunity Index. It's just a measure of inequality again. And what we're finding is that while you have a higher HOI value for primary education, meaning that there's greater equitable distribution of primary education services, there's a need for a more equitable distribution of secondary education services as manifested by a lower HOI. So, and this is something that we've seen in the data presented earlier. And so I think in terms of inequality across ethnic groups, we can see that disparities in terms of years of schooling and literacy appear to be narrowing between 2000 and 2010, as shown by the various inequality measures. And higher within group inequalities exist even among Muslim ethnic groups, while the non-Muslim non-ITs are generally better off in terms of years of schooling and literacy. And Filipinos have higher access to and more equitable distribution of primary education services, while lower and less equal access in terms of secondary education services. And I think this is partly due to the physical supply of school facilities. You have, as I mentioned earlier, you have an elementary school in every barangay, so there's no excuse really not to go to school. And yet, you know, we still have, what, 5-4% not going to school. So reaching this 4% is the challenge. Whereas for secondary schools, you don't have a secondary school in every barangay, so it makes it less accessible especially for the poor. But nevertheless, the Philippine government has been exerting efforts to improve access of ethnic groups to education. So we've met with the IP Education Unit of the Department of Education, and they've informed us about the different programs. There's also the IP component of the conditional cash transfer. And so we think that in terms of improving access to education, 4Ps, sending teachers to IP communities, although we've heard also some complaints about this, that they use Monday to travel to the community and they go down, they return on Thursday, so they use Friday, so you don't have the full week. But then you also have some very good practices in terms of setting up dormitories. I understand there's one in Panabo. And so you have a lot of good examples of how the access to education can be further improved. And I think this is one area also for HEIs. How do you design appropriate interventions so that you can actually address the problem? So is it always, you know, is it just dormitories, or can you offer additional or other interventions? So for instance, we looked at the data from DSWD, and there were 5 groups, ethnolinguistic groups, with the most number of IP Pantawid Pamilya households. So Subanon, Manobo, Sama, Bilan, Maguindanaoan. And so I think again here, is it because DSWD was reaching out to these areas, or the other groups were not interested in participating in the 4Ps program? So again, another area for research. So that's one part of it. I just wanted to show that looking at more disaggregated data can actually possible solutions for them. But I also wanted to show, there's a spelling, this is for Kiang and Ifugao, the kinds of information that might be useful for HEIs to engage in poverty research. So initially, I showed official poverty data that's disaggregated by region, because that's what the PSA, the Philippine Statistics Authority, can generate at this time. But at the same time, we also have, as Noel pointed out, we have that opportunity of having data at the local level that HEIs can take advantage of. So for instance, here in Kiang and Ifugao, which is implementing the community-based monitoring system, you can actually profile the community and see, okay, what's happening in each of the barangays. So for instance here, poverty incidence is highest in Daligan and Lingay, and you find out that the reason for that is there are no roads in those particular barangays. So again, the HEIs being there would be in a better position to be able to explain the causes of poverty and what could be done to address this. And because you have this local level data, you can actually come up with the indicators for the SDGs, such as the multidimensional poverty index, that puts together the different dimensions of poverty for the same household, which you cannot do, or you are limited to doing so at the if you use national level census and survey and surveys. And but you have that opportunity of doing that. And again, this is one area for research. You can play around with the multidimensional poverty index. What should go into it? What is important for that community? What should be the weights that should go into it? So there are many opportunities for research. And here, what I'm showing is just the school participation of children in 6 to 15 years old in Panabo. This mirrors what we've seen in at the national level, that school participation goes down for older children because they need to work, they need to make family income and so forth, but also that the school participation rate of girls is actually much higher than that for boys. So if you want, I mean, of course we want to be female, you want this, but you don't actually want, this is not gender equality, you want males actually equally to have the same opportunity as females, and so you also want, you might want to do something about this. So what could be appropriate interventions to address this this trend of higher school participation rate for girls? And this is for Panabo by barangay, and so you can actually see, again, this is from CDMS data, which is being implemented by local government units, and so you can actually see which barangays need some assistance in terms of increasing, and why is school participation low for some barangays. And you can also do the same by income quintile. You can see that the lower income groups tend to have lower school participation, although it's generally high in Panabo City. And then by ethnicity, you can again see, okay, which ethnic groups tend to have lower school participation. And so you could be more proactive in terms of increasing their access to education. And as for my last slide, what I wanted to show is, as I said in the beginning, it's really to show opportunities for HEI to engage in poverty research. So there's need for more disaggregated data. I think that's what we're saying here. If you really mean leaving no one behind, you need to have figures to identify who are being left behind. You cannot be contented with a 94-95% school participation rate. You need to find out who are the 5% who are not able to attend school. And that means you need more disaggregated information. And so that there's one, of course I'm biased because I developed this, the community-based monitoring system, which is being implemented by more than half of the local government units. And so so it can provide data that reveals disparities across barangays, gender, age groups, income classes, ethnic groups, and other socioeconomic characteristics. And right now, data is underutilized because of lack of capacity of local government units to analyze the data. So that's one area where HEIs can come in, and I don't think it's mutually exclusive to you to do poverty research, as Noel has highlighted, and also satisfy doing academic research. there's greater capacity building that's needed for local governments, and again, this, and I've seen many examples of HEIs working with local governments, capacitating them. There's more research needed to understand better the linkages of the factors affecting outcomes. So why is there low school participation? Why is there higher poverty in certain areas? That's a role for, I think that there's a very big role for HEIs. And more than that, I think need for innovative designs of appropriate interventions. The national level, for instance, you see there's low participation rate, initial reaction would be, should we build more schools? But no, we find that there's a school. Even in Pasay City, we're finding that there are many children not attending school, not because there are no schools, but there are other reasons for not going to school. And so you need research to be able to better understand, and also some interventions. Probably it's more economic than just the physical access to schools that's hindering children from going to school. And as mentioned by Noel, the RCT monitoring and evaluation is very popular these days. So there's room for HEIs to get engaged in terms of monitoring and evaluating many of these programs. PIDS has been engaged in many evaluation studies, projects funded by DBM and also in collaboration with other government agencies. And what we've done and what we will continue to do is to partner with HEIs in the region. And so there's scope for doing academic research, but at the same time, something that would be very useful to both national and local government. So I agree with Noel that we can, we should. We do. Thank you.
Thank you, Sadie, very much. So I think the two of you have given us a lot to think about, and I'm sure many of you are bursting to give some initial reactions. I'm going to turn over to Toby in a minute, but I thought just before we start, maybe we should just go around the room and just have everybody very quickly introduce yourselves so that we all know who is here in the room. Bruce, can I start with you over there on that side?
Thank you. I invited myself to the meeting, and I'm glad that you agreed. Thank you very much. Bruce Tolentino, International Rice Research Institute, and I'll say a little bit why we were very interested in this meeting later. Thank you.
Good morning. I'm Duna Ranves from NEDA.
Magandang umaga, Ruel Rabanera from Xavier University in Cagayan de Oro.
Good morning, Manuel Aquino, Congressional Policy and Budget Research Department, House of Representatives.
Hello, good morning everyone. I'm Maylene Rosales. I'm from NEDA Region 8.
I'm Coco Alcuas from Makati Business Club.
Franklin Quijano, former mayor of Iligan City.
Brother Armin from Dela South, but also worked with the Philippine Business for Social Property.
Kiko Magno from the Institute of Governance of Dela South University.
Bob Mendez, Resilience and Peace Building, UNDP.
Good morning, Sheila Aldaver from Notre Dame University in Cotabato.
Good morning, everyone. Akram Latif, IPDM, Mindanao State University, Marami.
Good morning, po. Red Constantino mula sa Institute for Climate and Sustainable Cities.
Good morning, Alice Ferrer from UP Visayas.
Maybuntag, I'm Feli Rabe from NEDA Davao Region.
Rachel Ballesteros from PIDS.
Sheila Sear, PIDS.
Justine Sikat, PIDS, UP.
Janet Concap, PIDS.
Maganda umaga, Fala Iliasan, UNDP.
Iliasan Ambao, UNDP.
Rowena Felipe
to... I should say, by the way, that we have some coffee outside. We don't have a formal coffee break because we thought we wanted to kind of keep the conversation going. But there is coffee there, and Toby tells me that banana cake's very good as well. So please don't leave that there. So you're very welcome to grab a cup as we kind of move forward with the program.
Hi, good morning. I'm Toby Monsot. I'm from the School of Economics and the Human Development Network. Launch is a very good word because I'm not sure how to launch this. Just to say that I'd like to recognize that the people in this room are not just HEIs. Right? There are people who are like former Mayor Quijano from Iligan City and NEDA regional representatives, right, and others. So I think the idea is really, if you look at the agenda concept paper, is to identify and discuss opportunities and constraints for promoting integration of efforts. While the output hopefully is gives some guidance to how to better harness HEIs, I think the context is really an integration of efforts, national, local, HEIs. No? So maybe we can, I was wondering if we could, just to get the conversation moving, is to take a step back. And rather than jump into the role of HEIs per se, but perhaps if you want to start reflecting on the current proposed agenda to meet this pledge of leave no one behind. Right? I guess the question being, what are your thoughts about the adequacy or the clarity of current policy, national or local, whatever is relevant to you, with respect to leaving no one behind. I guess at the national level, it's the BDP. At the local, at regional, there may be a regional RDP. At the local, there's still other development plans. So I think maybe we can look at that first to level off. What we understand about this pledge and the agenda, whether you think it's adequate, what you think maybe if there are gaps in both, either in the diagnosis or in the proposed solutions, right? Before we talk about, how to fill those gaps, right? So anyone, the floor is open. Yes, Mayor. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Thank you for inviting me here. I'm very glad of the presentation of Dr. Noel. The challenge that we must all be facing. I myself was a teacher of economics at HAI in Visayas, and all fed up with the theory I thought I should join politics, and I did. And so that was where I was able to coin the definition that the economist has all the answer to all the questions, but blames the politician if anything goes wrong. and I realized that really there's a gap between theory and practice, and there's much need to address this gap. And this forum helps a lot in bridging these gaps. Being from Mindanao, there are certain things that needs to really come out. And I hope that my colleagues in Mindanao will give me some liberality. One is, on the point of view of research, I think we need a lot for census. Even as we say there are 182 ethnic groups, there are no exact census to show that the population for these ethnic groups are these numbers. Especially with the recent discussion on federalism, the ethnic groups are more conscious of their identities and their directions. Even as we know that one of the concerns on No One Left Behind is really that there are dying cultures, there are dying languages, and even traditional practices. or industries. We were talking with Brother Armin here in Lanao. Even before the Marawi incident, some industries are dying. I used to be using the thick blanket, but then now it's very rare. The brassware, which is supposed to be the pride of the Maranao, because even before the Spaniards came, they had the guns and their brass were used. Is dying as well, some industry. So all these are actually intertwined: poverty, production, industry, culture, everything. And I think there's one key that can help in keeping up and addressing the no one left behind, and that is governance. There are so much gap in governance. For instance, one of the work that was bragged about as very modern is the IP law, the IPRA. So everyone thought that, you know, this will bring the IPs towards this century. And yet, when I had discussion with some friends with NCIP, I realized that the governance mandate in IPRA cannot be made possible because the legislation before it tended not to allow it to happen. I'm referring to the local government code. In the case of IPRA, the NCIP is supposed to promote governance in the IP areas. But as they wanted to participate in how government and how governance should be done, they realized that bringing it under the umbrella of DILG would mean that their governance would be affected all the more, because under the DILG mandate, the governance structure of the IP will be dissipated some more, because under the DILG, elections have to be called. And with the NCIP configuration, and the IP configuration, there are not supposed to be any elections except for the traditional leaders. So as we wanted to create IP barangays, it was clashing with the election process which the ILG tried to define. And so I have seen that in the map, Mindanao is really red. A lot of people left behind. I guess we can improve on governance, and in doing so, we would also be able to bring up the conditions of poverty and education. So far, these are some of my random thoughts. Maybe we can bridge on policy, create a law that will allow governance among the IPs without being interfered on by the ILG.
Before I call Brother Armin, just to make the point that the presentation of Celia is a national view of who is, it's one view of who is left behind, but it may not necessarily be so that that's who you identify at the local level. So, you know, policy can be at two levels. Brother Armin, and then
maybe three quick things. I have many things to say about education, but I will hold myself first. But one key insight that I got was through by being in the secretariat of the Zero Extreme Poverty Coalition. And that's a coalition of around 50 different NGOs, church-based ministries, all focused on extreme poverty, extreme poor, with a grand vision of bringing together, working together by 2030 to eradicate, to address 1 million families out of 1.2, I think, recently. But there are two quick insights in the last 2 years that we discovered. One, that among those of us who have been working with interventions for extreme poor, very few, maybe very rarely, are there any groups that have been addressing the extreme poor. Most of the programs, and in fact, we're looking for models that will actually address the extreme poor families. Secondly, that if you add up the investments of groups and then you put that together with government, it is possible to address at least extreme poverty. But the problem is, one, we fail to notice that it's multidimensional. So almost all of the interventions are focusing on just one, health, scholarships, etc. But your one intervention will not bring them out of poverty. Two, that the groups never work together. And I think to the point made earlier, that is a key problem among NGOs, but also with universities. My second point is, PBSP also works with the Water Alliance. And the only simple vision is to bring together a roadmap, local government, national government, and all the groups working on and concerned about water. So a big chunk of that is actually research. The first insight was that there are like 35 different government agencies with data, their own data sets. And they really never work together. So all government agencies related to water intervention never work together, and most importantly, never share the data. Secondly, of course, if you overlap the communities that are waterless, then you see all the dimensions of poverty. They're also the powerless communities. They're also the ones, I'm sure, with the less education and all. So. But just bringing groups together to just talk about one agenda is the biggest problem, because as Filipinos, that's our basic difficulty. And anyway, my last comment is, coming from the university sector, when you look at the challenges worldwide, it is impossible for any one university to compete internationally if we just work on our parochial agenda. Whether that's research or so. So to me, the main challenge for us is to have a rallying point where everyone is able to participate in a small way in a big project like poverty.
Thank you. History. In the 50s and 60s, we were all worried about what was being called at that time the population bomb, echoes of Malthus, the near starvation in South Asia was taking place. And here in the Philippines, we had a series of typhoons which led to rice rationing, and it was the precursor to martial law. So in the 70s and 80s, the government did Masagana 99, and it's coming up again. And in Masagana 99, the University of the Philippines at Los Baños and IRI fundamentally got together to put together the program that set up the mechanism for creating the high-yielding varieties. This effort was fundamentally backstopped on the science side by IRI, because at that time there was no Rice Research Institute for the Philippines. The Rice Research Institute for the Philippines is Phil Rice. It was set up only in 1986. So de facto, IRI was the Rice Research Institute for the country. And with input from Cornell and USAID, the program was created. And by most accounts, the program was a success. In that context, a lot of young scholars went to the U.S. with funding by USAID in the 60s and 70s. And that generation started coming back in the 70s, 80s, and 90s, and now they're dying. There's no replacement. for that generation of scholars who brought in the first seeds of science. At that same time, a set of generations from Asia, Thailand, Vietnam, Indonesia, all came here to learn rice research. And then they went back to implement what they had learned. We all know the history of Asian growth since the 70s. On the backs of the growth of the rice sector and the agricultural sector and the rural sector, the rest of the economy grew. That's very clear in China, Vietnam, Thailand, Indonesia. It's not so clear here. And the thing is that with USAID fading out of the scholarship game, there have been very few scholars since. The Asian governments, however, have continued to provide the scholarships to their people. Philippine investment in R&D is woefully low, less than about 1% of GDP. You compare that to the rest of the Asian countries, it's woefully low. That's why when you look around for fellow researchers, actually the density of researchers to population is very low, because we're not producing and we're not investing in people. If you look at scientists to population ratios, very low also for the Philippines, you compare it to the rest of the population. Very different from the rest of Asia. So our call is, let's invest in R&D. Let's invest. Just bring it up to the benchmark of that may equal us to Thailand, about 2% of GDP. Korea is 3.5% of GDP. Vietnam is 1.8% of GDP. We're among the lowest in terms of investment in R&D across Asia. And that's why among us researchers here, we often quarrel about the very few research projects that are available. Because there's not much being given out. UP, the UP system right now says they've got a lot of money, the budget has multiplied, but it's mostly going to buildings, not to people. And it will take a while before people investment programs catch up.
Good morning, everyone. I really like the presentation of Noel and Celia. Basically, one of the things that, as an academic, no, one of the things that I see when it comes to poverty, especially in ARM, IRMM, is that we've been looking at poverty as if it's an end of it all. But when you look at the environment, such as ARMM, and the real, you know, puzzle that you have here, ARMM, and then you have Northern Mindanao, the, one of the fastest growing region in the country, with its neighbor, ARMM, the slowest growing region in the country. This is really one of the greatest puzzle. So when I talk to this one guy, he's actually my thesis examiner, James Robinson, I said, it's very easy to explain the difference between South Korea and North Korea, but how would you explain two regions bordering one another in one country, having the same law, having a totally different trajectory? And he was puzzled. I said, we need to write a book on that. Why region failed? Anyway, I think the biggest thing when I look at poverty is that the enabling environment was not there. We look at poverty as that's the end. But actually, poverty by itself is a reflection of the underlying environment that enabled poverty to thrive. The Poor Peace Program of the country is actually one of the biggest contributor of poverty insofar as ARMM is concerned. Lanao del Sur, to be honest with you, Lanao del Sur is the poorest province in the country. municipality of Bacolod, Calawi, my municipality is Tugaya, the handicraft capital.
Your municipality?
Yeah, Tugaya, municipality of Tugaya. So my relatives are the one who make the brass ware. So once upon a time, World Bank, ADB, went there to look into municipality of Bacolod, Calawi. And because that's the poorest municipality in the entire country, what they saw is there's a lot of concrete houses, mansion, SUV, Fortuner, Innova, all of the nice car. He said, how could this be the poorest municipality in the entire country? So they were puzzled. This cannot be the poorest. And then when they asked the Philippine Statistic Office who do the survey, said we cannot do anything about that because if we go to a house who is park a latest SUV and ask them if they are poor or not, they will say, we are poor. Because if I consider myself poor, then there would be a bigger allotment for poor peace. In other words, we have come to a point in that part of this country where it pays to be poor. So the policy that actually aimed in reducing poverty is the very policy that motivates people to declare themselves poor so they would have a higher allotment for the poor peace program. So this is the reality on the ground that we don't see. Now, one of the thing is the, I'm trying to be honest here. I'm trying to be honest here. And people were saying, how come Lanao del Sur are so good in gaming the system? Gaining the system in a way that they gain the system, so they benefit a lot from the system. For example, Iligan City and Marawi City. Iligan City has a bigger population than Marawi. It has almost 10 times the land area. But when you look at the number of barangay, there are more barangays in Marawi City than there are in Iligan City. I think in Marawi it's more than 90.
Yes.
In Iligan, I think it's 40 lang, no? So in other words, why are there so many barangay? Because the more barangay they are, the more employment for the local chiefs, no? This is the same also with the municipality. We have 40 municipality. I think in terms of land area and I'm bearing out the truth so we could really analyze what's the problem. The thing is this, there was actually a failure of the local economies. And the local economy of Lanao del Sur, ARNM, is there is no opportunity for growth. When people, those who visit Lanao del Sur, you're from Davao, you're going to pass Lanao del Sur, going to ARNM, the first thing you notice as you drive from Cotabato, the area outside of ARMM, the land is very fertile, it's very cultivated, it's very nice. Once you enter the area of ARMM, the cultivation and the farming stop. So from that point on, you see the difference of the environment that create poverty. So because the local economy failed to produce opportunity for growth and livelihood, what happened is that the only place to seek improvement in life or to gain meaningful exit out of poverty is the local government or the government itself. So let me give you an example. Previous to the introduction of the internal revenue allotment during the time of Cory, barangay election is the safest. Actually, among villagers, they just appoint someone to be the barangay chairman. Ikaw na yung barangay, kasi wala magtatrabaho dyan. When the ERA was given to the barangay chairman, it create all the problem. And people from outside cannot understand, bakit yung nagpapatayan sa barangay chairman? Because since the ERA was created, there's been a lot of fighting, killing, and political violence. And I said, you outsider cannot understand the problem with ARMM. If you are in a very poor area, because your thinking is based on Manila or based in other developed places in the country, where you have opportunity for growth. But if you go to ARMM and you go to a place where there's no other opportunity to earn meaningful livelihood, and the only thing that will give you a chance to build a nice home, to buy a car, is the IRA from the barangay chairman, you will kill and die for it, because that is the only opportunity for you. Now, in other places like say in UP or Diliman, you don't need to die for it, because if you lose from being a barangay chairman, you can always gain other opportunity. But in that part of the country, that is the only opportunity. So these are the things that I see when you study poverty. You don't always look at in isolation of what's the local and the economic environment, especially on how people could earn. In other words, when you look at ARMM, the best approach there is to really create opportunity for people to gain livelihood and gain employable work. No? Last comment ko lang, no? When it comes to the discrepancy between boys and girls in enrollment, this is actually a common trend. In my classes, there would be 4 boys and there were 35 girls. No? And I've been seeing this trend since I entered the academia way back in 2007. So it's a puzzle. So, but I have a hypothesis right now. My hypothesis is this. I don't know if it's true or not, it's still a hypothesis, is that there is a different opportunity cost between boys and girls. If you are a boy, your opportunity cost is very high compared to a girl. Kasi kung if you are a boy, you can always play basketball, play Dota, play go somewhere else with barkada. So that is a very big opportunity when you are a children, no? The high school, everything. But if you are a girl, that opportunity does not exist, because if you don't go to school, you'll do the house chore. cleaning the dishes, the laundry, everything. So for a girl, it's better to stay in school rather than do the house chore. Or if you are a boy, I would rather play Dota and go with my friends. So that different opportunity cost between boys and girls actually create the thing that we see today that will make women empowerment obsolete. Maybe in the future, there will be men empowerment, because in my case, the breadwinner in most cases are now female. And when you go to remote area, rural area. Yeah, sorry, napahaba. No? Thank you very much.
Before we go, I've been assured that if you want to say something off the record, it will be kept off the record. So no problem. And I actually was asking if you want to take off your hat. You don't have to speak for your institution, but as a professional, your own insights from past experience, that is okay too. Yes.
I'm actually being forced into reacting, and I think it can drag on and waste some time. So I was trying to suggest to Dr. Parker that perhaps in the afternoon we should go into small groups or into breakups, because marami ng reactions sa mga pwedeng sabihin.
So just to up to this point, no, what I've gotten so far is you're saying, number one, there is a coordination problem, right? This is what Brother Armin is saying, among actually specifically central government agencies. I mean, you're 35 agencies, so I'm connecting that to. That's why sometimes we cannot solve a problem, because there's this huge coordination problem. There's data, but they're not shared, right? And other things. Mayor Quiano is saying it's a governance issue, especially at the local level, right? Where there's some incompatibilities between governance and what needs to be done, so that people are not left behind. So the powers of governance and so forth. And I think what Dr. Akram is also saying now is that I think the main point is that it really depends on the
politicians, right? And I think that speaks to the possibility that there is, it's not exactly the same, the central government agenda and a local government agenda. And I think you have to keep that in mind, right? So perhaps you can, please. Dr. Manan.
First, on the team, on the one left behind, I think that there will always be some that will be left behind, to be practical about it. Basic statistics. We are aware that in any bell curve, there's always the outliers. So there will always be outliers in any programs of government or any institution for that matter. The other part of this outlier is because these outliers can be also vertical, in the sense that the world of the world as seen by national government is not the same as the world as seen by the local people. And national government tends to be overbearing in terms of policy impositions and regulatory impositions, and yet very blind about the realities of where these policies are to apply. And so the tendency is the national level, say Manila or Davao, they look at the Philippines like a bell curve. And so their policies are based on what are in the cluster of the middle of the curve. And that's usually a statistical mean rather than in reality, the actual. The distribution is so vast and so flat that our policies do not actually meet most of the conditions that are actually seen in the field. So that's this part about not left behind. My second view is about the assumptions on HEIs. The discussion seems to assume that HEIs have the capability to innovate. We have the capability to innovate, but do we have the capacity to innovate? Capability, yes, there are many bright people in academia, that's their business, use the mind. But with all the regulatory impositions of CHED and the DepEd, we are made to do things according to what Manila wants, rather than according to what their constituencies in Dumaguete or in Iloilo or in Naga want. So, for example, we want to produce educators, we want to produce teachers. We would rather have teachers who would be capable of teaching in the realities of Negros Oriental, for example. But no, there is a specific number of hours that BSEN graduates have to do, and to do this study result, for example, is one imposition. When for many people they don't even know who Rizal is, I'm not trying to exaggerate, but we cannot fit according to the localities because there is a imposition of a uniformity at the national level. So ito yung isang reality na yan. Unlike, for example, in the US or other countries, a university can be a university according to how it wants to be. Nobody tells MIT or Stanford what to offer and how to offer and what will be the constituent content of their courses. But not here in the Philippines. Even Gen Ed is to be specified what are to be the content of general education. Right? And if some teachers say foul that their courses are not anymore included, government has to also include them again. So this is the kind of reality that why teach Filipino in Mumbaranao, for example? That's the one. Then the third point is about poverty and HEIs. What is really expected of HEIs? If you listen to the Makati Business Club or other people in industry, they say there's a mismatch. They talk of mismatch. We need to produce graduates who can be employed and demanded by industry. Again, we are talking of a demand side imposition on HEIs to produce capable individuals. I think SEI should be a supplier of capacities, people who would be able to think out new ways of doing things. Imagine new employment opportunities that are not there before. Many of the employment now have not been there 5, 10 years before. So where are we really? What do you expect of ECIs? And second, if you have to expect something with ECIs, are you giving the ECIs the real freedom to do things the way you think it should be done? So these are the fundamental policy issues that I think hamper this assumption that ECIs can do things and give us the freedom to address these issues.
Yes, Dr. Shin.
Good morning, and thank you for promoting me. MD pa po ako. So, in the context of pledge to leave no one behind in the Philippines, in the context of HEIs, I think I fully agree with the reflections of Dr. De Jos. Relate na relate po ako, sir, sa mga sinabi ninyo. Coming from a private education institution, we can only do so much. With regard to providing education to poorest barangays or municipalities, that's, I think, is the more traditional role of HEIs, specifically in the context of where I am, where my university is located. We are serving Maguindanao areas. I would like to disagree with the presentation of ma'am with regard to access to education for elementary education. No? Because in the areas that we are serving, we have actually 24 elementary schools in 5 municipalities in Maguindanao. And even in South Upi, including South Upi, catering to IP children, the access to school is really a problem. So there are more school-age children between 4 to 15 years old who are not in school because of access. And these are the children who cannot go to a 5-kilometer or 6-kilometer deped school because of their age. No? So medyo malayo po yun. So, sa reflection ko, no, being the our role, no, in leaving no one behind, especially in the interventions that we do in our university, we can only do so much. No? Coming from a private education institution, na wala naman kaming support coming from the state, no, or sa government, so we can only provide access through partnership, no? And I really appreciate partnerships, especially in the area in Southern Philippines, kasi medyo may donor fatigue na ba, sir po. So ang dami po doong mga ano, no, mga INGO supporting really local initiatives coming from the HEI. So that's one, no? So I think ngayon palis na po kami dun sa aming school, no. We have turned over to DepEd our elementary schools, starting from kindergarten up to grade 6. Now we're turning them over to DepEd. But of course, the challenge really is, can DepEd really sustain, no, what we have started? This is a supported program of OSAID, but of course, it's now being turned over to DepEd. So ang tanong is, sustain ba yung sinimulan, no? So that's one. Second, the partnership between academe, HEIs, and the local government units, no? I fully agree in terms yung problem in terms of governance, no? Because in our area, especially in Maguindanao, I agree with Sir, no? Those who are in positions, elected positions, they are the ones who are blessed with, big houses, no? Parang yung disparity po nung, ano, is talagang makikita mo, no? Malaking bahay ng mayor, Barangay Cafe, ang katabi lahat is mga shanties. No? That's really observable in the areas where we serve. So, again, ang isang reflection din namin in working with these communities, yung barangay BLGU, no? Barangay Local Government Units, they're not really empowered to do their mandate. No? Like, for instance, providing allocation coming from the ERA, allocation for education. Wala po yun. No? Hindi mo po you cannot demand from the local government that they have to provide this program for out-of-school youth, to provide this program for the school-age children. No? They do not have that budget, actually. No? They're also constrained. Okay, so yun yung second point. And third point is on research. Sir, Dr. De Jos mentioned about research in the academe. Frankly speaking, tama po yun. We are really challenged by research capability, no? Especially yung publishable researches. In the university where I am, we are actually partnering now with UP, no? And Ateneo de Manila to really also propel research in our academe, no? In the university, because sabi nga is publish or perish, no? And that's one criteria, sir, no? As Dr. Ben Malayang was saying, that this is one of the criteria to really become as mandated by the regulatory bodies, no? On research. And frankly speaking, yung research po on poverty alleviation, in as much as universities would like to really engage on poverty alleviation, in our case, no, medyo mas dictated po yung aming research, not necessarily dictated siya ng mga stakeholders sa ano, no, sa paligid. Like for instance, even sa ngayon, parang may mga flavor of the month kasi, no. Like for instance, in the area where I am, mas ano ngayon yung peace, yung violent extremism, no? So, yan lahat, yan yung mga ano. So, parang tama yun na we really have to have this, yung data, no? As Dr. Celia was saying, yung disaggregated data on per barangay, no? As to really have a statistics on especially on education, no? As many universities can really put into. So, yun po yung aking mga reflections din sa leaving no one behind.
Yeah. Sir, and then Red and Coco, I understand you're leaving after this morning?
I thought you read my mind and I wanted to see.
Third, one, two, yes. Three, four. Okay.
Yes, good morning. First, thank you very much. Even myself, I've gotten lots of insights from the ground, especially from all of you, from the mayor. Now, my two cents work. I think it's very important in this regard. I'd like just to make certain comments. When the former NSCD was there, I was asking, why are we still using decades-old survey for nutrition? When we're using a nutrition survey, which is decades old, is that relevant for planning purposes? I asked. So, together with the then NSCB, nakablo kami to get funding for a new nutrition survey under the GAA. And the chairman of the appropriations committee asked us, where's the proposal? So we look for the proposal for a nutrition survey. And there was none. Why would there was none? Because the department or the agency felt that a survey would go beyond the limit of the mandatory 5% ceiling. Natakot na matanggal. So bago pa dumating sa DBM, tinanggal na niya. Hindi dumating sa Malacanang, hindi sinubmit na Malacanang sa Congress. Kaya nung hinahanap ng chairman, walang proposal. Now, I think a year or two ago, nag-present sila ng nutrition survey, bago mga data, stunting, etc. Good. Where did they get the money? I said. Ah, nag-scramble ang NSCB at saka yung noon na kumuha ng funding from multilateral or international agencies. But is that sustainable? Diba? Now, so, yun ang tingin ko na ang datos importante. So, dapat mapondohan. So, hindi lang sa local, sa national pa rin. At least, dapat yung mga ganong surveys na critical to find out where they are, where the starting is, where the malnutrition is, should be funded. And it should be in the statistical development plan. Now, we had another point. We had interns from Muslim Mindanao, the Congressional Internship Program for the Muslim Youth. Tied up with UP, NCPAC, they had very good research proposals. Tinutulungan namin sila doon sa mga papers nila with UP. Ang problema, yung mga bata, walang makuhang dato kasi walang datos ang ARM. Lahat ng mga ahensya, ang gaganda ng mga proposals nila about which is critical to the locality. Yung isa, value change ng wala silang makuha ng mga datos sa infrastructure, sa nutrition, sa health education. Bakit walang datos ang ARM? Even the Muslim youth were asking themselves, bakit sa aming mga Muslim, wala kaming datos? So, fair game. Now, there's also the question of CBMS. The CBMS is definitely good for the local, but not all localities are covered by CBMS. Now, there should be an interlink, I think, between the PSA and the CBMS. Pero magkaiba ng approach. Nung bringing up namin doon sa consultation ng Statistical Development Plan, magkaiba ang approach ng CBMS at saka PSA. Mukhang ang PSA gusto i-mine yung administrative data na existing. Perhaps this is where the higher educational institutes could come in. How could they tie up with CBMS and PSA, whatever method you use to mine the administrative data that is existing or that is to be supplemented? Kasi sabi ng PSA, ang daming administrative data, hindi nagagamit. So I think that's one area for HEIs to consider. Now, with respect to the local Sangguniang, critical ang datos at yung Sangguniang para sa policy making sa baba. Nagkonsultasyon kami a few years back in a big city ba yun? A municipality in Mindanao. First class. Ang sabi ng head ng Sangguniang, problema namin, wala silang magandang capacity para maka-implement ng magandang polisiya kasi kulang sila sa kapasidad. And perhaps this is one area where the tie-up could be between the HEIs and the local Sangguniangs who makes the policies for the locality. Kasi yung mismong head ng Sangguniang na nagsabi sa amin. Now, one area also na pinag-uusapan ngayon na pwedeng gawin perhaps ng HEIs is big data. Kasi kung minsan hindi na surveys, hindi na etc., kundi big data na ang ginagamit to project yung mga poverty mapping, etc. Ang dami nilang innovative techniques na pre-set kung saan pwede magamit ang big data for all of these targeting purposes. Not necessarily specific persons, but areas. I think this should be considered with the PSA, which is also discussing big data. And I think the universities have big data initiatives. Ang isa pa is, in the last KPCs, I think the World Bank, last, just last month, nagkaroon sila ng KDC sa Dumaguete. Yeah, and I think that's one area of collaboration among the universities and the institutions. In fact, what some of the universities were actually asking our office if we could provide them with topics which could be done by their students for research. So ngayon, naghahanap kami ng mga pwedeng listahan na pwedeng magawa sa mga estudyante ng mga universities. So, I guess marami na ako nasabi that for now. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks, Libby. I'm not from an HEI, but my organization does work with local academia, state universities. We seek them out based on our work. And I guess some of the contributions I can make to this meeting, although they may be a little bit narrow in terms of issues, I think they're really important to consider. And I'm really glad I was here because the presentation of Noel earlier was pretty striking. There's one slide there that struck me, the one that said, why it may be right, feasible, and helpful. And there are five items there that I think encapsulated why we're doing what we're doing at the moment, and which is working on climate and local academia. It spoke about humanitarian and social foundations of HEIs, novel pedagogy, cross-disciplinary collaboration, and the importance of local research. And I also was struck with by the presentation of Dr. Reyes. What went through my mind as I was listening was not really the current as to the current situation of the national picture, but what it might be in the next one or two decades. And that forms a large part of our work, which is not simply how to pull people up, but what will likely pull people down without dramatic intervention. Our work on climate has often been given us a lot of anxiety. So just to use one example, as far as certainty is concerned, the best target of the Paris Agreement in terms of climate safety, which has to do with 1.5 degrees above pre-industrial level, that's the highest, most ambitious target. And yet, if we reach 1.5 degrees, if we keep temperatures globally below or at 1.5, which is the most ambitious part, it still means that by 2050, globally, we will lose 90% of coral reefs, globally. So the best, most ambitious target means that the world will likely just retain 10% of its reefs. So when the question comes as to research, local research, the big question for us has always been, what of that 10% will be from the Philippines? And if we look at the big question marks in terms of research agendas and local state universities and big ones, big HEIs, we always wonder why this is a big driver of ambition, rather than simply looking at academic standing globally and ranking that is, we think, fraught with different factors. The thing that is the most relevant and the most urgent is actually probably going to be part of your leading edge in terms of academic work. And that's just about coral reefs. It scares us because if you don't get to 1.5 and we reach 2 degrees, a fraction of a degree, we will retain only a 1% globally by 2050, if not the virtual extermination of reefs worldwide. These are slow onset impacts, which is very much the opposite of episodic extremes, which unfortunately most of us are obsessed about, but is not the most concerning. The slow onset impacts are the ones that are taking place without the drama of calamity and without that enough attention by research, scientific research, governance research, and impacts that will take place with, where I think one of the bigger messages also is not just to academe or non-government actors, but also to development partners of the country. Because as far as slow onset impacts are concerned, this is one issue which is to us very, very much stuck, because a number of the agencies that are working on this have been unable to look beyond one planning cycle, when in fact this requires several planning cycles, up to 18 years or more, to see where the huge humanitarian and political crisis and conflicts may come up based on certainties that are already projected, things that are irreversible, things that are likely to happen over a couple of decades, which still lacks data. For us, it's also an opportunity because we work very closely with CPBRD, Director Aquino, and your team have been very close partners of ours, including Benguet State, Visayas State, University of Southeastern Philippines. In terms of looking at what the local data dearth is and what research is already produced. The global scientific community in the IPCC, actually, there's very little that's been produced and submitted by Philippines scientists, and it's one big opportunity, and so CPBRD has been looking at this. And why I think the House helped form the Special Committee on Climate Change, not because of impacts and massive deaths, but because we know so little, and it asks the basic question, what must be driving our research agenda? We also see the climate crisis as a very important opportunity to be integrative in initiatives. In fact, this is one reason why we're working very closely with some local government units and some local academic institutions in our role as a member of the People's Survival Fund, because this is one huge area that academic institutions should be able to see in terms of driving their research forward. It provides finance, because this is what universities should be doing to LGUs, hopefully from the provincial level, in terms of informing the LGUs of vulnerabilities, looking at development data, and then functioning, playing the role of monitoring and evaluation across different proposals. That the first four has already been approved, and there's probably about 10 to 20 more that's going to come up in the pipeline too. A large part of this obviously relates not only to climate impacts, but also opportunities in the low carbon transition, and sideways thinking. Really, most people think of the climate crisis and solutions in the realm of stopping deforestation and low carbon energy transitions. In fact, from our scan of a lot of studies, one of the more important things that struck us, and which reminded me from the presentation of Dr. Reyes, was that globally, it has been seen that while population is not an issue in the climate crisis today, it will become an issue eventually. And it's not population, but women's empowerment seen as a key driver towards stabilizing global temperatures, because women that were educated and girls were educated would produce smaller family sizes and use resources better and so on. And that's the kind of integrative work that we see. We hope will come out more and more from economics, engineering, sociology, and hard science departments in universities. Thank you.
Thanks,
Jeff.
Sir?
I'm sorry, Coco first, yeah, and then, yeah.
Thanks for calling.
I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
Keep on. Yeah, Ms. Rabe is no.
Please go
Coco first. You've been raising your hand since Canada.
No, please,
I'm
let
so
her,
sorry.
Let go. Go ahead.
Please, Miss Rabe, yeah, and then Coco, and then, yeah.
I'm so sorry. Yeah, the first time I raised my hand. Was it really? Okay, never mind.
Good morning, and thank you very much for the informative presentations and the meaningful insights of my colleagues. Regarding my reflection on No One Left Behind, I was just thinking that given that many interventions have been given for the poor from the government, from the private sector, why is it that there is still poor in our country? And I have been thinking that, for example, given to families who are poor and who receive the same benefits, the same interventions, there's a possibility that one of the family improves its lot while the other remains poor. So there might also be a factor, and this can be a topic for research. So there might also be a factor on the attitude of the person, of the family, and how that family responds to those interventions. Because as we can see, two poor neighbors, and given the other has access, given scholarships and access to education, both are given, the same opportunities given to those families, but we can see that it also depends on the response of the poor themselves. That's my just a thought. Thank you so much.
I'll keep it short because I don't have much contribution to make except to say thank you for inviting us, and thank you for all the insights. I wasn't really gonna say anything, but I wanted to react to something that Dr. Ben said. He's my kababayan pala. My mom is from Dumaguete. And I think he knows of my lolo more than I did, because I never met my lolo. Dr. Ben mentioned that groups like us talk a lot about the jobs mismatch, and maybe may not be concerned about the future jobs mismatch. We're concerned about both. In fact, we're trying to work with some groups about the second part, the future jobs mismatch. But even when we talk about the current jobs mismatch, I like to assure other organizations that it doesn't just come from our principals' desire to fill their offices, fill their factories, their construction crews and service crews. It's really a link to the number 8 SDG, which we're trying to work with UNDP, which is good jobs and economic growth. For whatever reason, we see jobs as the driver for economic growth and economic well-being of the poorest Filipinos. I was very interested in what both Dr. De Dios and Bruce talked about, and we talked about the lack of research. And we are trying to figure out a way to get into that area in some way. We don't have a crew of PhDs with us, but we want to work in that area. All of that said, there was a very interesting article in the Washington Post this weekend about the solutions to all the world's problems actually already being in all the unopened PDFs. I think the World Bank, there's a World Bank study about their PDFs, which said that 1/3 of their PDFs have never been opened. And I think only 10% have been opened more than 200 times. Which is why, on our end, we are very interested in what Brother Armin is doing with the Zero Extreme Poverty. While we're interested in research, we would like our projects to have a KPI of accomplishing something concrete beyond the research report. And when we look at the Zero Extreme Poverty project that Brother Amin is heavily involved in, it's that I think the answers are already there. It's just a question of linking them and implementing them. So just those two thoughts. One is the reason we're interested in trying to figure out what kind of education is needed is not just to fill the offices and factories, etc., but because that is, in our minds, that good jobs are the way to economic growth and economic well-being. we'd love to get into those studies with some of you, but also if there can be a KPI that's constructive and concrete, we would put a premium on that. Thank you very much.
A lot have been shared already, but what I'd like to focus on is a more focus on agriculture as a sector. It has been presented earlier that our economy has been growing since 2012, 6% or higher, and yet we have so much poverty still, 22%. But if you look at the details, for example, if you look at the growth of the industry and services, they're really high. But if you look at agriculture, it's very low, even negative in some years, and it hasn't grown. And maybe, you know, if you look at the where the poor people are, most of them are in the rural areas, 3 out of 4. And if you go deeper, they are actually in the upland areas. And I think that's also the reason why we need to focus on indigenous peoples and all of that. They're living up there, so isolated, and I think the services can reach these communities. And I think that's question has been asked, where are they? Who are they? But I think that's an important point that we need to at least build on, because in coming up with strategies and all of that, I think this would be the fundamental data that we need. And I think Dr. Bruce has already, in a way, gave us a historical perspective. We have been the leading country before in agriculture, but now we are lagging behind. And for us, for example, we have the ERIE in the Philippines and many more research institutions. The problem, maybe it's not on having more researches. I think, as mentioned earlier, the unopened PDFs, it's really more extending knowledge to the communities, and that's where we are, I think, have a major constraint. Some time ago, extension has been devolved to local government units, and unfortunately, many of the chief executives do not see agriculture as a priority. And therefore, while we have so much, or in terms of knowledge and maybe even skills, these are not shared with those who are really in need, like the farmers or the indigenous communities themselves. In Xavier, for example, we have attempted, we have this big project like bringing science to the communities, to the poor communities. But, of course, it was welcomed by the chief executives, but we cannot sustain it. Again, the capacity issue is a major issue for higher institutions, educational institutions. And it's really affecting a lot of the different sectoral groups, even higher education institutions. I know in Siliman, there's a problem. They have been offering before agriculture. But when your enrollment goes down below 50, students, then we have a problem. And again, the budget, even the criteria that we need to satisfy actually would really go beyond our own capacities as well. And I think that kind of dynamics would have to be addressed, again, from a bigger perspective. Because if you look at this from just an institutional perspective, maybe the answer is not there. We've tried several attempts already, linking with LGUs. Well, it worked for some time, but once the mayor is changed, then we go back to zero. Sustainability is a major problem. But I think maybe what I'm trying to emphasize here is that we need really to collaborate, to link up, because we need to extend all the sciences and these technologies and knowledge to the community.
Dr. Magno, and then, the last three who haven't spoken yet, Alice and...
My reflection focuses on the avenues for promoting the inclusion of the poor, inclusion and empowerment of the poor. There are participatory mechanisms for in the area of local governance, but I civil society organizations as representatives of the poor are given 25% of the seats in the local development councils. But what is the quality of participation? In the ladder of participation, there is a continuum from tokenism to meaningful participation. What is missing here is the participation of HMIs in what I believe to be a very important in the local governance ecosystem. Because if you sit in the local development council, you will be engaged with data and budget planning and budget prioritization. Are the CSOs supported by local think tanks? So I believe that local HEIs can be the local budget analysts, conducting local budget research, and what Celia mentioned, using CDMS for local research. And Noel mentioned that action research is probably one way to go. And I look at different journals, and there are action research journals that are listed in Scopus. So it will address the competition, the being more competitive. Now let me share what our the LaSalle Institute of Governance has been doing in terms of looking at how we can engage and be part of this local governance ecosystem. In 2010, we had a project with Andrew Parker and Brother Armin, fostering partnerships with 7 higher education institutions, including some of those are in the table right now, Xavier University, Siliman University, St. Paul, and Tuguegarao University of San Carlos, basically part of the Knowledge for Development Community Network. Ironically, LaSalle was not part of the KDC at the time. We later on became a partner. The main idea really is to foster the participation of HEIs in the local governance ecosystem by developing local monitoring and evaluation tools that can be used by local civil society organizations. And eventually, these local civil society organizations became engaged in local development councils. After the World Bank project, we continued with this cooperation with different donors and with a much more reduced scope. So we were able to get support from Sea Oil Foundation, so much scaled down, no? But we retained Xavier University and Central Philippine University as partners, now together with Ateneo de Naga. So hindi po totoong nag-aaway ang LaSalle at Ateneo. Volleyball at basketball. And much more recently, we had a project with the Making All Voices Count. And this is where we really develop local budget analytics, and there are now websites operating at Xavier University, Ateneo de Naga, Central Philippine University, producing infographics, budget reports, also still limited. But what is interesting is that these websites are being used by local government, by the local governments themselves. Initially, we thought that we would just like to provide this kind of tools for civil society organizations. But since they are open, these are open sites using open data. And it's really a way of leveling off information and evidence. So in the future, I think that HEI shouldn't anymore engage in voters' education, where they will basically say these are the good candidates. But just produce performance assessments and good old research. Thank you.
Yes. regions in the country, I believe that we stand to benefit from the discussions here. Eastern Visayas is the third poorest region in the country. We used to be second poorest, but thanks to Yolanda, we are a notch higher, no? A lower, I should say, in terms of poverty incidence ranking. We are, I think, one of the regions in the country where poverty has really been very pervasive. And I've been with LEDA for the last 27 years of my life. I've worked with several administrations and presidents already. And in fact, I have been a part of the formulation of several development plans, no? So many PDPs and RDPs, et cetera, et cetera. But yes, the same question prevails. Why are we still poor? Okay, and for my very own region, Eastern Visayas, it could be parang ano eh, heartbreak na eh, to a point of being a heartbreak already. And just last week, I had an opportunity to visit Singapore. And we still have a long, long way to go. Although, of course, size is a factor, because Singapore, comparatively speaking, is relatively much smaller in terms of population. They only have 5.7 million as compared to our 100 million as a country. And in terms of size, they're even smaller than the second most populous city in my region, which is Ormoc City. So now the question, that gives me a more, that exposes me to a lot of, you know, what is happening outside of the Philippines. And I just had a realization that I don't know off the record. Masakit mang sabihin, pero parang gusto ko nang maniwala na the trouble with the Philippines could be the Filipino people. Oo. Although you will disagree with me, I know some of you will disagree with me, but it's just striking that, you know, even their citizens, no, young children, are already trained to become productive citizens. And we visited one university there, National University of Singapore. It's so amazing that they have this incubation space for even young students, which will enable them to become young entrepreneurs. And talking of entrepreneurship, we have been talking about the lack of entrepreneurial spirit. For my region, we have remained to be a consuming region all these years, no? But actually, going back to Brother Armin's point earlier that poverty is really a multidimensional thing, I fully agree. Because in Region 8, poor economy, check. Okay? Poor economy, check. We have never hit our target in terms of GRDP as far as the regional development plan is concerned. It's always been spikes and dips, but we never hit the target. Except in 2016, when we became the fastest growing economy in the country. But they all say that's a pseudo growth. It's just a big, you know, plastic balloon that could burst any time because of, it was just an effect of the massive reconstruction activities after Yolanda. In fact, if you go down the figures, it will tell you that I think it was driven by the industry sector. And if you go down deeper, it's attributable to the growth in the construction subsector. Okay? And low investments we have, no? We barely have, I mean, in terms of private investments, maraming nadi-discourage na magpunta kasi there's high power cost, and that's despite the fact that we're supposed to be the geothermal capital of the Philippines. And then we have, of course, peace and order problems. We still have bouts of insurgents. And then, although employment in this part of the country is even higher than the national, we have a problem on underemployment. No? Underemployment. And if you look at the distribution of where the poor are, it's really the farmers and fisher folks. That's why I would like also to thank you for pointing that out, sir. We really need to focus. focus on our farmers and fisher folks. For the longest time, I think this is a national phenomenon, but for Region 8, it really means a lot because we are dependent so much on our marine and agricultural resources. Anyway, who our poor are, it's mostly the farmers and fisher folks. So unless we're able to do something about our agriculture sector in Region 8, I think we will just be, you know, inching forward, moving so slowly. And then, of course, our high vulnerability to all types of natural hazards. Yes, typhoons, earthquakes, we all have them. Right now, we are even experiencing massive flooding. But, well, part of it could be, you know, it's naturally induced, but there's a big human factor there. Maybe we are not constructing our, you know, we are failing in the infra part, no? Poor drainage system.
Is corruption a natural
hazard? It's a man-made hazard, sir. although the...
It's natural.
And politics, and yeah, governance. You also pointed that out earlier. But you know, talking about this, I was listening to the presentation earlier. I just thought that maybe it's really high time that, well, actually we have hatched the idea of really having a study on what really are the factors behind the pervasiveness of poverty in Eastern Visayas. What makes us a poor region compared to the others? Is there really something in our region, no, that pulls us down? And we are also looking at the possibility of the dismal performance. Sorry for the word, but I'm sure Samarenius will not like it. But it's really the dismal socioeconomic performance in Samar Island as a whole. I'm talking about the three Samar provinces that comprise the entire island of Samar. And to think that Samar Island is the third largest island in the country. Yes. After Mindanao, yes. So, siguro ang point dito is, unless we're able to do something about, you know, for us as a region, in Samar, really push it, no? Wala sigurong it will continue to have a cool down effect for Eastern Visayas region. And being the third or largest island in the country, that would definitely have a negative and adverse impact on the on our situation as a country. So yun, we are trying to focus now on Samar. I'm even looking at the education indicators. Ganun din. We talk about access to water and all the Watson facilities. Ganun din, poor din ang Samar. And it's just unfortunate because they have all the natural resources in the world. So now, what we really want is to come up with probably an evidence-based information on why we are poor. So actually, we proposed to the LEDA Central Office, we have an R&D fund. That is quite a lot, no? But unfortunately, our proposal was turned down off the record because one of our bosses there said that your research proposal has a social slant, and NEDA, if ever we're going to conduct a research, should have an economic slant. I'm not sure if I understand that, but parang mahirap mano eh. But decipher anyway. So I'm not toying with the idea of going back, you know, leveraging on the presence of the state universities and colleges in the region. We have 10. I think we are in terms of the number of SUCs in the country. We are 30 at that, no, sa dami. So we have that. We have the SUCs. Maybe it's high time we partner with them as far as engaging them in a research like this. No? So,
let's
continue. Okay. Oh yes, of course, aside from PIDs.
Okay, let's hear from Dr. Alice and then I'll try to wrap it up before that.
Thank you. Actually, I'm asking myself why I'm here. Maybe it's because of Toby. But anyway, what I would like to share with you is a question. You asked a question, why we still have many poor. Maybe the answer is because we did not target the right poor. There are many ways to identify them, and at this time, we rely on the household targeting survey. And as we know, we have a lot of problems in the field. I just would like to share with you a big project we had, this one in Eastern Visayas. During the time, this is for health, so possibly a health project. We did profiling of the households. 41 LGUs in Leyte, and we covered 20,000 plus households in a short period of time. But when we went to the field, knocked on the doors of these households, we know that they are not poor. So, but I just hope that, you know, they were able to refine the methodology. And the problem at the time was, of course, WG has the data set, but it's very difficult to access the data set. Even DOH could not get, it would have been a lot easier for our part to, you know, just visit. But we have to have our own data set because we could not access their data set. And at the same time, field health was to profile also the poor and the vulnerable. So at the end of the day, you have three data sets, not shared. So that was, so we're able to profile a big number, and supposedly when intervention came, field health was doing another intervention, and the health intervention wasn't given attention because field health, the health people at the ground level had to prioritize field health because field health was giving incentive. there's a big problem we have right now, how to really identify the right poor. Just to give you a very good example, very localized study we did in our LGU. This is just very small, involving four barangays, I think, and 250 households. We asked first the community, what to them is poor, being poor, who are the poor, and something like that. We let them identify the characteristics of the poor, and then identify who are in the community are the poor. And then out of the 250 households, only I think about 40 are in the list of poor peace. So this only shows why the community to them, the project has no credibility. I mean, they are not happy with the selection process and so on. But of course we know the reason why the community or the local officials were not part of the selection of who are to be in the poor peace. So that is just how do we look for the real poor? That's a big problem. With regard to the role of the HDIs, I would say, yeah, we do research on the poverty. The main problem is really how to communicate the results. Our researchers are not trained to communicate. They are trained to do research. Communicating the research is another skill that I think most of us researchers do not really have. It's another level. So most of our, and then of course there's that push that we should publish in international journals. So who would read those reports or those results? They are not given to the users of the information. And of course, how would you, when you sell your results to the LGUs, of course you want their buy-in, but if they're not there at the very start of your research, buy-in would be very difficult. Aside from, of course, letting them understand what you're talking about, so that's communication, and the buy-in is another thing. I also would like to share with you one big project we have, also again, in your region. We are supposed to verify the coverage of ill health. At the time, it was said, it was about in the 80s, and we were told the instruction was for us to verify that number. We were able to identify in a very short period of time, that was just amount of time given to us, we had to verify that amount, identify the true coverage of ill health. We have to do a lot of thinking how to do the work in so short period of time, innovation, exploration, whatever the protocol. But at the end, they were able to come up with two protocols. And these two, active targeting and the passive one, so the one involving schools, so a lot of partnership with DepEd and so on. And the other one is passive, using the common data set. So there's a lot of, we did two manuals for that, and we were able to identify up to the individual level, those who are eligible for health insurance but do not have health insurance. We're able to identify all those people. It's just as we were told that it's supposedly the protocol will be rolled out to the rest of the country in the 17 regions, but it was sort of frustrating because it did not happen because of the changes in the leadership up there,
the
DOH field health and so on. But it's ready. If we do that at the same time in the 17 regions, we can already identify everyone who do not have field health but eligible for. Of course, that's NHIP, in the same field health, NHIP. So, yeah, those are just some shared.
Thank you.
Okay, what I'll do is, this is by no means the end of the conversation, but we have to break for lunch. And let me just 4 points which I think have been coming out strongly. First has to do with the question, well, what do we expect of AGIs? And it seems to be what's arising is that there's really two levels. Now, what does national expect and what does the local expect? Because there seems to be maybe a divergence in terms of what is needed. Like you're talking about there could be overbearing or blind impositions from national, whether it's on the curriculum or what or research needs. And Dr. Sheila was, in a way, said, you know, we're doing violent extremism, which is not the education, but that's okay, right? We're saying maybe in your area, that is the research agenda for leaving no one behind. And is that less valid than the concerns, for instance, of PIDs with respect to ethnic groups, right? So, you know, which one will be supported, right? Is it the local agenda needs or is it the national? Is there a contention there and how is that going to be resolved? The second point has to do with data. You mentioned the statistical ecosystem and you know the fact that sometimes the CBMS for it does not talk to PSA data. And is that, the question is that an issue? Do you have to have seamless data or at least a coherent ecosystem? And if that's the case, then for local policy, are there data requirements that are simply not being met because of the overwhelming requirements coming from national government in terms of collecting data, which are rarely used, right? Something like that. So that's the LG capacity to use data. The point was made that there is data out there, but it's not shared among central government agencies or among central and local government agencies. A case in point, the National Nutrition Survey, which we cannot get the public use files of, akadim na kami, di ba? They just won't give it to us, right? And I think this is, if only that changes, right? If just there's a data policy shift that compels central government agencies to share tax-paid data, right? Then we may get more out of it. But then the question is, also, can HEI help local governments who seem to have data but cannot convert it to information, right? The third point is the tension between the long view and the short view info needs and the long view needs. I think Red brought that up. What's this? Okay, so it's like, do we lean count as to who is left behind or do we take a look at what can bring the whole country down, right? So that's the, in his example, it's the slow onset impacts without the drama of typhoons, right? Versus data to be able to react to typhoons better. Those are two different needs. And the question is there a niche for academe, for long-term studies, which are really not in the agenda right now. It's not a driver right now. And finally, the whole thing about local pathways that Dr. Magno pointed out, there's a lot of local pathways to make an impact on leaving no one behind and poverty reduction, but those pathways sometimes are impeded. And there could be a well, coordination problem. PDFs are not read, you know, or you can't communicate research so that locals can apply it. And I think this speaks to the unanswered question of why are we still poor? And just to say that the Human Development Report of 2013 also asked that question, and one of the things that it came, one of its hypotheses is it could be because the agenda has been centrally driven and not locally driven. And so solutions are centrally packaged and not locally appropriate. And so maybe that's one thing to look at, precisely why we're still poor. So for instance, in Region 8, one of the things was just geography is an issue, right? Surigao, Eastern Samar, they share a similar geography. They're both one of the poorest regions. So the question is, given that geography, should the approach still be like all other regions where you're trying to develop locations rather than simply the human capital of people so they can move, right, and be mobile? That's a very different agenda. And it is not a GIDP agenda. So if you're targeting GIDP, you won't catch that. You know, are there other targets that should be reflected in the regional development plan given the specific conditions in that region? So these are all parent connected, right? And we can continue. Yes, sir.
Just a quick one.
Yeah.
I think part of the simmering issues that that was a very swell summary of the discussion, but I'd like to add that I think there's an issue about scale.
Yes.
Many people and many institutions are doing the right thing, but they are not the proper scale that will really
scale
up or scale down.
Or scale down.
To be sure that they are appropriate to the level of the the other one is visibility. We think that we need to only report the results of our research. We can also report what's happening, what we are doing. For example, Mr. Constantino was talking about institutions trying to do something with understanding the oceans and the seas in respect to climate change. We in Silliman, for example, I'm sorry to use this, we try to trace, for example, the origin of the fisheries in one place as against where the propagules were coming from. And we're going into a joint study with Newcastle University on the biological oceanography of the inland, the seas in along our islands. We're doing this, and these are exciting things, but we have not yet published because it's not yet the so-called criteria for publishability. But we can already talk about what we're trying to do so that if some people are interested, then they will say, hey, let's learn from that, and then let's do something like that. So again, visibility is another one. But the most important, I think, is, similarly around the discussion this morning, the autonomy to be able to do things.
Thank you very much.
Sir,
let me break for lunch.
One day, I just would like, just for the record, I really would hope that whether it's CBMS or PSA, that certain, you know, accurate data should be generated, more importantly on the IEPs. We don't have correct numbers.
Mm-hmm.
And even the Muslims are complaining. In 1930s, the Muslims are 2.5 million. And with the number and their practice, they're supposed to have four wives. But their number now is still 5 million. That's just for the Muslims. What about for the indigenous peoples? How many Subanans, how many Higaunos, how many Manobo are there? There is no accurate data on this. But I hope it will be included as well.
Okay, thank you. Let's break for lunch. And